Good evening, everybody. So I'm just going to present Neurobiology of Addictive Disorder. This presentation is also very important to understand why a particular particular person develops addictive disorder. So basically, we go from the basic of how this neurobiology of addiction works and why the persons are predisposed to have addictive disorder and what is the relevance of the treatment. So once the objective of this session is, once I will complete my lecture or the session, you should be able to list three pathway and three cycle involved in the development of addiction. So what are the salient features of the addiction? As you know that the addiction is a chronic relapsing medical condition. It has three components. One is the compulsive behavior to take the particular drug or the stimulus. There is a loss of control, not able to limit the intake of the substance or the stimulus. And there is a negative emotional state which follows once the stimulus or the substance is not available. It's a treatable medical illness. It's chronic, as I have already discussed, and it involves the brain circuit, which I am going to in detail in the further slides. And it has a complex interaction between genetics, which gives a biological predisposition, and environmental risk factors. So, as I have told, addiction can be defined as a chronically relapsing disorder of the brain, characterized by compulsion to seek and take the drug or the stimulus, loss of control in a limiting intake, and emergence of a negative emotional state such as dysphoria, anxiety, or irritability when access to drug or stimulus is prevented. This is a treatable chronic medical disease, involves complex interaction among the brain circuits, that is the reward pathway, stress pathway, and self-control, along with the genetics and the environment and individual life. The 50% risk of the addiction is genetically. However, it involves multiple genes, which have a very small contribution or small fractions are involved. In this, basically, it is a kind of a polygenic inheritance. So it is very important, any case you are taking for history of addiction is to take a family history. In the family history, in the first degree relative or second degree relative, any substance use disorder is there or not. The remaining 50% of the risk is presumably mediated by the range of environmental factors such as early life adversity or peer pressure. So this is a neurocircuitry reward pathway. Okay, so here the prefrontal cortex is there, and then the in midbrain ventral tegmental area is there, and then limbic system, amygdala, nucleus accumbens, and hippocampus is there. So what happens with the ventral tegmental area will give a dopaminergic nerve ending to the further reward pathway circuitry. The prefrontal cortex is involved with the glutamatergic projections, and the nucleus accumbens gives a GABAergic projection. In the subsequent slide, I will explain how this works. So what happens with the addictive drugs? So whenever the substance has been taken, whenever the substance is taken by a particular individual or the by the individual, what it activates is a brain reward region. So it will the reward circuitry basically work in the mesocortico-limbic area. So which I have actually explained in the previous slide. So when the mesocortico-limbic area is involved, there will be dopamine surge will be there, and the person will feel the persistent euphoria. Okay, which also, what are the stages of the addiction cycle? So addiction can be conceptualized as a three stage. So one is a binge intoxication stage. The other, second is a withdrawal negative effect stage. And the third is a preoccupation and anticipation stage. So what happens in the binge intoxication stage? So there will be persistent euphoria will be there. So once the person has taken the substance, there will be increased dopamine release will be there. So once the dopamine release is there in the mesocortico-limbic area, what will happen? There will be behavioral sensitization will take place. So how the what is the behavioral sensitization? Behavioral sensitization is a concept where the persistent dopamine release to drug-seeking behavior and motor behavior regarding for the drug seeking. What will happen further after that is that there will be incentive salience will develop in the binge intoxication stage. Incentive salience are the environmental stimulus, the neutral environmental stimulus will be coupled with the drug seeking behavior, and that will make so it will have an acquired incentive, motivational values will be there. So what will happen, thus whenever this environmental stimulus will come, there will be cue induced craving will be there, where the patient will have intense craving to take the particular substance or the particular stimulus. What again happens is that there's a decrease in the dopamine surge with the non-drug responsiveness cues. All this all this both incentive salience, acquired incentive motivational value, and decreased to non-drug responsiveness cues predispose person for the drug-seeking behavior. Next stage is withdrawal or negative effect. So what happened with the chronic drug abuse results in the counter-adaptation, which is due to the negative reinforcement result. What happens, apart from the reward pathway, there's a stress-related pathway also work. So what happened, there are certain neurotransmitter like CRF, norepinephrine, dynorphine. So these are the neurotransmitter which starts get recruited, which actually works in the stress-related system. So what will happen? As the stress-related system will build up, the patient will have a dysphoric state, which the negative hedonic state, which will again predispose a person to for the drug-seeking behavior. So there's already reward deficit behavior is there. So reward deficit behavior means without the substance. So there's reward is due to the particular substance only, and due to, for the neutral stimulus, the dopamine release is not there. And already there's stress circles, stress-related system will also activate, which will form the negative hedonic state, which both will combine will predispose a person for the drug-seeking behavior. Within system neuroadaptations are there, between system neuroadaptations are there. Within system neuroadaptation are those in which the primary cellular response element to the drug adapt to neutralize the drug effect. And between system neuroadaptation in which the neurochemical system other than those involved in the positive rewarding effect of the drugs of abuse are recruited. By this, it means that initially the dopamine get elevated, later on in the later stages the other neurotransmitters such as glutaminergic neurotransmission, GABAergic neurotransmission, dynorphine, CRF, they all actually works, they all start gets recruited in a way to give a positive rewarding effect of the drug of abuse. Now the third stage is a preoccupation and anticipation stages there. Basically, it involves a prefrontal cortex and it has a go and stop system. So go system is basically for the, it involves anterior cingulate cortex and the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. Stop system basically is to reduce the craving and to reduce the positive expectancy of the substance, which involves a ventrolateral prefrontal cortex or the orbitofrontal cortex. So what happens, the initial stages of the substance use starts with the impulse related, would be more of impulsive, and then following it goes to the compulsive. So what will happen, like in an impulse control disorder, there will be tension arousal before the impulsive act. Once the impulsive act has been done, there will be pleasure, relief and gratification, and subsequently a person will feel regret, guilt or self reproach. In a compulsive disorder, there will be anxiety, stress, and to reduce the anxiety, stress, the person will involve in the repetitive behavior, which will have a relief in anxiety and relief in stress, and then the subsequent obsession formation occur. So what happens in the initial stage of the substance use, there will be impulsive. So what will happen, the person will go and take the substance, will have this euphoria, and to feel euphoria, he will again go involved or indulge in the substance use. What happens in the later part, over the period of 1 year or 2 years, it shifts to compulsive use. So now the person is already in a negative state. As soon as he is not indulged in the substance, there will be dysphoria, there will be anxiety, there will be stress related to substance withdrawal. To overcome the substance withdrawal related anxiety stress, the person will start indulging in the substance use. Hence, there is a positive reinforcement initially, and then subsequent, the development of the negative reinforcement takes place. Now, how this drug of abuse act initially at the synapse? So some of the substance will mimic as a neurotransmitter by activating receptor such as morphine, nicotine, cannabis, marijuana. Some of will block the dopamine pump. So that are cocaine, amphetamine, and some of the drugs will activate inhibit channels such as alcohol, ketamine. Subsequent, they will form a second, third, and chemical messenger, and there will be long-lasting, enduring changes will be there in the brain circuitry. So, regarding the vulnerability, so the brain maturation starts from the posterior to anterior. So, the posterior part of the brain will develop first, and anterior part of the brain develops later. So, the prefrontal cortex at the age of till 25 years, growth and development stages are still there. Other brain part will mature before the prefrontal cortex. So what happens? The subcortical circuit, the subcortical limbic area develops much faster and much before the prefrontal cortex mature. So this immature prefrontal cortex with more developed limbic region lead to imbalance or disruption of top to down control, which underlies the adolescent typical behavior such as impulsivity and risk-taking. We can just understand it. Suppose there's a vehicle in which the engine is mature, but the brake systems are not working. The prefrontal cortex system is a kind of a brake, which has to be there to take care of the high risk taking behavior, impulsivity, or other risk taking behavior. So, what are the high risk for addictive disorder? So, we can start from the family loading, the genetic loading. If there is a first degree relative is there, or substance use disorder, family history is there, early onset of use is there, that is before 25 years of age is there, or in adolescent if the use is there, exposure to the developmental stress is there, externalizing temperament, ADHD, conduct disorders, those things are there. Any psychopathological states such as bipolar or antisocial personality disorder is there. So relevance to treatment is it's a chronic disease, needs long-term treatment. The multiple focuses on the vulnerability and the psychosocial, multi-pronged approaches, pharmacological, psychological, physical, and community level. And the outcomes differ from patient to patient and to substances to substances. So take home message for this class is addictive disorder are the chronic, relapsing, and treatable medical diseases, involves the genetic or the biological vulnerability in connection with the environmental risk factor. There's a transition from impulsive use to the compulsive use. The treatment focus will be on the biological vulnerability as well as environmental risk factor.